So the enemy's trying to attack my gift, but he's defeated.
Yes.
As long as you can hear what I'm saying, we're going to have a good time in church this morning. We're so glad to have our members, our visitors, our attendees. You all welcome here. We're glad to have you in the presence of the living God. And everything depends upon your faith this morning. If you're ready to receive a word from God, you will receive one. If you're ready to go to sleep, you will go to sleep. But I'm telling you, if you lift your faith this morning, God has a word for you. God wants to speak to you. God wants to do something for you in a new and amazing way. Amen. We're going through our series, Protecting the City. What is the city? Your city represents your life. Everybody say, my life.
My life.
See, your life is a city. Your family, everything you own, everything that you are. Your hopes and your dreams, those are all a part of your city. Your city also represents your accomplishments, the things that you've done already. Has anybody accomplished anything? Let me see you raise your hand. Amen. Do I have two or three people willing just to tell me an accomplishment, something you've accomplished? Let me see a hand. Yes?
I got a master's degree.
She paid for it online. She didn't actually earn it. She earned it. Anybody else, something you've accomplished? Raise your hand. See, now you messed up. Nobody want to raise their hand. Now you messed them up. Yes, sir.
A bike ride from yesterday.
A bike ride from yesterday. All right. For those of y'all who've been on my Facebook, you know I have an accomplishment, too. You got to look it up. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Amen.
If not, faith without
works.
What is the work? Expanding the boundary. What is the work? Building the crib, painting the room, looking like you're crazy, getting all together. What's the work? Buy the wedding dress, and ain't nobody ask you to marry the man. Because you've got to take a step somewhere.
Amen.
You've got to show the Lord by something that you do that you actually believe in what it is that you're talking about. We're talking about building walls for our city. Psalm chapter 138, verse 8. We had an awesome wedding yesterday.
Woo!
Yes!
Woo!
I'll let them tell you the whole testimony. But 5 minutes before I got here, that's when my voice was gone. So here I am doing a wedding, no microphone, nothing like that. And I'm like, Lord, you know, it's just a sense of humor, this ain't funny. And I'm not laughing. But to tell you what God did, Andrew and Kashmir got married.
Awesome.
And about 4 or 5 of their family members got saved. Concerneth me. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. Forsake not the works of thine own hands. You ever heard? This is an A and B conversation, so
see
your way out of it, right? You see your way out of it because this conversation does not concern you. See, some of y'all pray more for, you know, running into Jay-Z or Beyonce or something, no mistake. Some of y'all pray more for free tickets to a basketball game. Some of y'all, your focus and your attention is on stuff that doesn't even concern.
Come on, let's go.
You want to jump in it. You know, I don't like what is happening in Texas. Do you even live in Texas? You have a family member in Texas?
All right, let's go.
I can't believe a so-and-so still in the basketball team. Do you play for the team?
Come on.
Do you own stock or share in the team? We're consumed on Facebook. We're consumed on Twitter. We're consumed in conversation with stuff that doesn't even concern us.
Right.
Your house is on fire, but you worry about somebody else's.
Right.
Your relationship is jacked up, but you're commenting on somebody else's.
Right.
Your health and your physical body is jacked up, and you're talking about somebody's hair in the Olympics. You ain't even been to that. You see, the Lord is not just going to perfect stuff. He wants to perfect the stuff that concerns you.
Amen.
Stuff that's your business, stuff you have to deal with. See, God wants to work with us internally. Well, what's wrong with the world? Not wrong with the world, it's what's wrong with us as individuals. If individuals get right, the world gets right anyway. Because the world is nothing more than just individuals. So where's the problem? The fixing of the problem starts with you. Can you become better? Can you become stronger? Can you become more diligent? Can you become more faithful? You know what? God might be waiting for you to just take one step in the right direction before everything around you changes. He will perfect that which concerneth me. Deuteronomy 28. Let's go here. Deuteronomy 28. We're going to jump around. Verse 1 through 3 says, and if you faithfully obey the voice of the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments, and I command you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth. How many of y'all want to be high? You want to be exalted? You want to be successful? We're not talking about proud. See, my thing is, if you're going to be in it, you may as well win.
Let's go.
Don't be proud of it. If you're going to be in school, be the valedictorian.
Amen.
If you're going to be married, have the best marriage.
Amen.
Right? If you're going to walk out the door, have the best day. Why not? So here's what God wants to do in our lives. It says, and all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you. That means God wants to do exceedingly, abundantly, above even dream. Okay, if you obey the voice of the Lord your God, verse 3, blessed shall you be in the what? City. So we're talking about walls of your city. Blessed shall you be in the city, and blessed shall you be in the field. The Lord will command the blessing on you in your barns and in all that you undertake, and he will bless you in the land the Lord your God is giving you. Now stop there for a second. We might remain there. All right, let's just stop there. We're going to stop right there for those first three verses. Now, we want to kind of break this down and look at some things here. So the first thing I want us to look at is this. We've got to be obedient. Mm-hmm. How many of y'all struggle with being obedient? Be honest, you know. Let's talk about why. Tell me why. Why do we struggle with being obedient? Let's go. Why do we struggle? Yes.
We think our way is right.
Okay, we think our way is right. Anybody else, please? Why do we struggle with obedience? Yes.
I have my own agenda.
I have my own agenda, yes.
We don't look from a different perspective.
Okay, we don't look from a different perspective, yes.
Pride.
Pride.
Pride just throw, obstacles at your life.
Obstacles, very good. Anybody else struggle with disobedience? Yes.
Because sometimes it's hard to be obedient. It's harder to do what obedience may, you know, entail.
Okay, sometimes it's hard to be obedient. Okay, anybody else, why do we struggle? All right, now here's the key. Obedience is the key for everything else God wants to do in your life. Obedience is the key. Obedience is the key. Let me tell you one of the reasons why we struggle with obedience. If you can find this verse, please put it up. The Bible says, parents, provoke not your children to anger. I want to put that up there. Because a lot of us, our parents and grandparents, told us the verse, children, obey your parents. In the Lord, for this is right, but they ain't taking the other side of the story. See, one of the things that helps us, I might get in trouble for preaching this, but I got to preach the truth.
Amen.
One of the things that helps us to rebel and struggle with obedience is when we're submitted to people who expect us to do stuff that we can't possibly do anyway.
Amen.
Do it. Why? Because I said so.
Right.
And look, I'm not a dog. I'm a human being. And if I'm old enough to ask you why, maybe I want to learn something. Maybe I want to have some understanding. Maybe I want you to teach me. Maybe I'm not being rebellious. But sometimes we are shut down and put down by the people that we are submitted to, and they train us to become disobedient. You see, God will never put more, but people will. I know I'm on a black campus, but I have a concern with pledging fraternities and sororities. Why? Because that dude who didn't mean to push me over the cliff, pushed me over the cliff by mistake. Why? Because he's not God. The dude that caused me to do something, they dropped me off in the woods and they thought I'd find my way back. Why? Because they're not God. See, God knows how far you can go before you go over the cliff. God knows how far you can go before you get lost in the woods. And so because many times we've been submitted to people who abuse their authority over us just because they have authority, by the time we get to God, we are disobedient, not because we're rebelling against God, but because we just don't know how to be obedient anymore because we've been abused so much.
That's good.
Is it up there yet? Provoke. I mean, the Holy Spirit's not even my notes. I got to go here. Because, see, some of us can't work because we're broken. You're not bad. You're not rebellious. You're not, what did Paul say? The thing that I want to do, I find myself not being able to. The thing I shouldn't do, I find myself falling. Why? Because I've been trained the wrong way. Paul was killing Christians. He was real good at killing people, making people have a bad day. That's what he was practiced in. Some of us came to college out of rebellion. Whatever I can do to get away from them crazy knuckleheads at home, I don't want to hear my mom say nothing, my dad say nothing. My wife went to Hampton because she wanted to party. She says that's why she went to school. She wasn't looking for no degree. And so the foundation of the decisions that we're making in our lives are based in rebellion because we don't know how to be obedient. What is the solution to that? Now, I'm not repping our church, but I am going to rep our church.
Amen.
The solution, before I talk about my church, I'm going to give you something else. I took my first Zumba class on Saturday morning. I will give you a small explanation. Most of them are like over 50 years old in the class. So Pastor, not struggling too much. I'm okay right now. And it's, anyway, it's not, if it's a problem, I would walk out. Amen.
Amen.
And if I couldn't focus on the exercise, I'm saved enough to say. But in my journey for exercise and working out and getting healthy, anybody struggle with your weight or your health, just working out and eating right? No, act like you want no problems. I'll find it. I'll keep saying stuff until I figure out what's wrong with you. But in my journey, see my wife, she's big into having like a trainer or a coach. I don't like that. She's right. Big into having, you know, somebody, you can do one more, whatever. I might hurt the person, right?
Yeah.
And lose my joy, lose my testimony.
Right.
So I have to find, listen, I have to find the kind of exercise that I'm willing to submit myself to. That's what I need. I didn't go there for nothing else other than I need to find a way to sweat, and this other stuff is not working right now. So I have submitted myself. Revive Church, especially for some of you college students and young people, we want to be the kind of ministry that you can feel comfortable to submit yourself to, because we want to be the kind of spiritual fathers and spiritual mothers. We want to be the kind of leadership in your life that will retrain you on how to be obedient without breaking your back.
Amen.
Without giving you unreasonable stuff. Anybody ever been a part of a church where you had some family members who were part of a church where the leadership was just ridiculous? Come on. Well, Bishop said, I gotta pick my nose. Bishop said, I gotta wash his car. Bishop said, and it's stuff where the kids grow up and say, I don't even want to be a Christian. So I'm touching on some stuff here. I know I am. So God says, I want to reintroduce myself to you. Powerful story comes to mind. Anybody ever heard of Magic Johnson? Anybody? Only remind you, anybody ever heard of Larry Bird?
Yes.
And so what happened for many years, man, these guys had rivalries, even back in high school, you know, college, I mean, you know, professional sports, they had these rivalries back and forth. And I forgot what happened. They were either doing a commercial or something for the Olympics or whatever. And so they had to get together to film something for the paycheck. Ain't no money will bring folk together. Whether you like them or not, you can smile to get paid.
That's right.
So they came together. This is a true story. You can look it up. And so they were going to record this video or this recording at Larry Bird's house on his property. And so when they pulled up there, Magic Johnson came with his trailer because he was determined, I don't even like this guy. We're going to shoot these commercials. I'm going back to my trailer. I'm going to stay there. I'm staying out of his way because we are enemies. I don't like him. We don't like each other. So Larry Bird's out there on the spot. So they start doing a commercial, and Magic Johnson's about to walk back to his trailer. And Larry said, hey, man, why don't you come eat dinner with us? So Magic was like, they might want to poison me. Like, what the So he went into the house, sat down, Larry Bird's mother was there, began to feed them, and Magic Johnson's heart melted. Larry Bird's heart melted. They became the best of friends. Why? Because they got an opportunity to be reintroduced on a different playing field.
Yeah. Come on, that's good.
Come on, God is speaking right now. I'm not even in my notes. God is speaking right now. And so what has happened to some of us, we think we know who God is.
Yes, that's good.
Wow. I promise you, a lot of you don't. Why? Because you know him regurgitated through somebody else. Food that is chewed up and spit out by someone else does not taste the same as it was in its original form. And many of you, that's the only Christianity you know. What you saw Bishop Eddie Long do, or Bishop so-and-so do, or what they did on TV, or pastors of Charlotte. When I come out, I'm going to preach the word. I'm going to be on it. I'm going to get it all straight. Right there. Some of y'all not laughing. It's okay. You're going to laugh later when we get home. Maybe you don't know, Larry Bird did not know the real Magic Johnson. Magic Johnson did not know the real Larry Bird. The only way they knew each other was on a basketball court. And of course, if you're on different teams, you're not supposed to be friends. You're trying to beat the other person any way that you can. And some of us are already enemies of God because we've never met him for ourselves. God's been waiting for you. Look at you. You sit in the classroom on a Sunday morning, you call it church. God has really, he has really set you up. Why? Because he's not trying to trick you. He just has been. Has anybody ever been misrepresented?
Yes.
Let's be real.
Yes.
Friends, family, loved ones, you can be misrepresented. And then somebody gets an opinion about you based upon what they heard from somebody else.
Right.
God wants to speak to you directly.
Yes.
Concerned whether you consider yourself a Baptist, a Methodist, Episcopalian, a Church of God in Christ, you know, whatever, Presbyterian, we can go all day long. He wants to have a personal. Listen, Jesus never died on the cross for a denomination.
Amen.
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 If not, there have been 50 crosses. Today I'm dying for the Baptist. Today I'm dying for Church of God in Christ. It was one death for an individual people because he knows where you are. He's willing to meet you where you are. It's kind of funny. So why he died on the cross? I've got so many awesome answers from scripture. But you ever thought about this? Because there was somebody on a cross who needed to be saved that day.
Come on. Let's go.
That's good.
Wow.
But he could have died anyway. All he died and rose, right?
Yeah.
But maybe God set the whole thing up because Jesus didn't need to die for himself. He needed to die for that thief over to his left.
Yeah.
And see, I feel the anointing.
Wow. That's good.
See, for whatever reason, the thief couldn't call an Uber and make it to church that day. He was tied up. He was hemmed up. So Jesus said, I'll come and die, not just for you. I'll come and die with you. He will find you right where you are. Some of y'all might have messed up last night. You might have sniffed, snorted. Maybe you lost your virginity yesterday. God still loves you.
Amen.
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 See, your city represents your life. And you only have one life to live. I don't care how young you are, you only have one life to live. You've got one shot to get this right. We all make mistakes, we all mess up, but at some point, you can destroy your city to the point where it's hard to rebuild it again.
Come on. Yes.
And so God is saying he wants to perfect that which concerns you, but the first step is obedience. Obedience to what? His word. Obedience to what? His will. And if it's something too hard, he will give you the grace to do it. Because he will never put more on you than what you can bear. We need to leave this place today, if nothing else, say in our heart, God, I'm willing to be obedient to you. I'm willing to listen to what you have to say. Why? Because God is not telling you something that concerns him. He wants to deal with something that concerns you. God already has his mansion. You don't. God already has, whether it's cars, I mean, he's got what he needs. Amen. He's trying to hook you up. He's trying to help you out. He's trying to bless what concerns you. But the first step is obedience. And the first step of obedience is obedience to the cross. You might say, well, Pastor, there's a whole lot of stuff the Bible says and I can't do. I struggle. It's hard for me. You're not alone.
Amen.
I can't do those things on my own either. But the first thing I did was to say, Lord, I surrender my life to you. I give my life to you. I turn my life over to you. You know, here recently in the Olympics and some of the different sports, you'll see some of these athletes and you'll hear about how they find their coaches. How they fired their coaches, or they got rid of a trainer and got a new trainer. And see, what happens is you have to give someone permission to train you. You have to give someone permission to coach you. And sometimes we sit back and say, well, God, you're the God of the universe. Here go a problem. If you want it fixed, fix it. Fix it, Jesus, like you said you would. God says, look, I have full authority over the universe. But I have no authority over you unless you give me that authority. Because if you don't give me that authority and I take it, I am now a thief. Your heart doesn't belong to him. Your heart belongs to you. It only belongs to him when you give it to him. And so this morning, God is speaking to us about obedience, about being blessed, about how he wants to take care of us, about how he wants to bless us, and how he wants to bless everything in our lives. God wants to bless us. I'm going to do a quick demonstration, and then we're going to prepare to close. If I can get that one person over here again. That works. And then three people to be his wall. Let me get three people who've never come up before. Let's do that. Come on, sir, in the back. One. Can I get two more? Okay, come on. And then, all right, yeah, come on. Come on. Yeah, all y'all come. You can take four. I want you to stand in front of him in a semicircle, facing that way, soccer style, like somebody about to kick up. A field of you. I knew somebody was going to do that. Those who know about soccer. Okay. And so we learned last week. We learned, that's right, nobody come to that one. Zumba time. Amen. So we learned last week that our wall is our boundary. Our wall is our protection. And it's smart to have walls because the walls work for you. Tell your neighbor, they work for you. Now what's smart for you to have to work for yourself or for your walls to have to work for you? Does that make sense? And so it has to do with decisions you make up front. It's better that you post and let folk know, here's what I don't do, here's far I don't go, I don't kiss on the first date, I don't do this, I don't care who you are, here are my rules. Now you can go chill. But if you have no answers, you're always like, well, let me see, let me think about it. Ain't nobody got time for that. So you set up your walls, and your walls automatically protect you. They automatically take care of you. So we talked about how these walls are, and we talked about the battle that you fight against the enemy. So from a spiritual standpoint, these walls are too close to Alan. So there's a battle. Man, some of the bricks might hit him all the back. So take two steps forward. So the smart thing to do is, YouTube, yes. The smart thing to do is to have convictions that go beyond the word. Amen. Can I show you a principle? So in other words, if my heart rate gets to 6, whatever that means, I might die. I need to have my heart rate at 4. I don't want to find out. You know, I don't want to find out. Let me tell you a quick story, real fast. Can I do it real fast?
Yes.
All right. So there was an older man, and he used to have a horse and carriage, and his carriage driver died. So he was looking for a new one. So he put an ad in a newspaper because it was old school, and a few people signed up for it. The first person came out. He asked him a question. He said, "How far can you get to the cliff without falling over with my horse and my carriage?" He said, "Man, I can probably get, you know, probably 2 feet before you fall over." He said, "That's real good. I might call you back." Second person came up. He said, "Sir, how close can you get to the edge without falling over? I want to see your skills. I want to see how good you are." He said, "Man, I can probably do within 1 foot and still have you on the ledge." He said, "Man, you got some skills." He brought the next person in. He said, "How well can you do? How close can you get? I'm paying a whole lot for this job. I got lots of money. How close can you get?" He said, "Sir, I can get in within 6 inches.
Come on.
He said, "Wow, you have some skills." He said, "Stay right there. I might be calling you." The next person came in. He said, "Sir, how close can you get?" He said, "I have no idea. I'm going to stay as far away as I..." He said, "You got the job. You 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 got the job." You got the job. So we should set our walls ahead of time. Now for today's lesson, take 2 steps back. In fact, go all the way back down so we get some more space. Till we get to Bojangles, we kind of cramped you. Okay. All right, so come close, all right. Now this is where I'm gonna call the faith wall. This is not the battle wall. This is not the fighting wall. This is the faith wall. Because God wants to bless what?
You.
Oh, that was masters? No, I was kidding. Yeah, God wants to bless. It's like, "Man, stars with a U, man, stars." God wants to bless that which concerns you. If you're worried about a car, He wants to be your car helper. He wants to be your mechanic. Come on. You know, if I'm in a courtroom, I don't need a doctor. I need a lawyer.
Right.
See, He will become whatever you need because His goal is to bless you in the area that concerns you. All right. So here's what happens. Man, here's a man of God. He's gone to church. He has an awesome wall. This is his wall of faith. I need somebody with a pretend measuring stick to come up. Who can do a pretend measurement for me? All right. Okay, there he is, Kim. All right. You need selected by. All right. So stand back there and just kind of measure and come and show us what the measurement is between him and his wall. Okay. All right. All right. Very good. Very good. Now, follow. I'm about to close here soon. We're gonna get really deep into the spirit here, okay? Okay, turn it sideways so we can see very good. That's all God can bless him in.
Wow.
Because that's his only measurement within his walls.
Wow.
Well, now, he's got the walls. I know I'm supposed to be in church, and I know I'm supposed to read my word, and I can speak in tongue every once in a while. I go to church on Easter. I go, you know, so you got yourself a wall. But God's like, "Why are you limiting me?"
Yeah.
See, the first part of my sermon today, I said, let's celebrate our accomplishments. We understood how to celebrate that because our mind tells us that's all I need my wall for is the stuff that I've done, the stuff I saw grandpa. But you see, God wants to do exceedingly, abundantly, above whatever you can ask, imagine, hope, or dream. And when you don't move your wall forward, you are limiting God's blessing in your life. Now, push it back. Why don't we move it forward? Because we really don't believe. I'm speaking to myself too. You know how dumb I would look to get a building that could hold 2,000 people, and if nobody shows up, come on now. You know how tough it was for me to come out here and preach with no voice, but I think God's doing it. Can y'all hear me? Saying to you, He's saying to us, if you want to see God in a big way, you got to make more room for Him. You got to push your wall forward. And I used to make fun of South Carolina, and I guess I still might. But years ago, whenever you drive through South Carolina, you see like 5 acres of land, in the smallest trailer house somewhere in the corner of all that land. I'm like, what is wrong with these people? But you know what? They got the acres.
Yes.
If they ever want to build, they can. Now see, here's what happens. God starts moving. Let me see you moving back there. God start moving, start doing great things. Now I want you to bump into your wall. We're not playing none of that out. Just go. And then you know what he says? Open your mouth like you're talking. Satan, I bind you. See, we getting somewhere now. Satan, I rebuke you. And the devil's like, I didn't make that wall. You did.
Amen.
You the one that said you could only get a bachelor's. You did that. You the one that said I can only have a date with a man who won't beat me up. You said you won't get pregnant by the time you're 25. You said you don't have enough money for school. You built that wall. All I did was help you to fulfill it because of your lack of faith.
Mm-hmm.
When you come back next week or whenever we get to it, we're going to talk about a man named Jabez, whose prayer was, Lord, enlarge my territory. Take a step forward, just one. Not because I deserve it, take one more. And not because I have anything to put in the empty space, take one more. But because I'm believing you for greater things. Can you stand up? I believe in you for greater things. Somebody give God some praise on that. I believe in you for greater things. I believe in you for greater things. Do you know what has built my faith? Some of you don't know me. Please keep coming, because I'm a person. I'm not just bishop.com. I'm a person. I have a story. And for me to be on a college campus, you know I ain't here for the paycheck. But feel free to surprise me. But you know I'm not here. Listen. I have a story, and I believe the way God, the way that I do, because my faith has been increased. My wife and I and five children moved here to Charlotte by faith from Virginia, just because God told me to. Without a penny of promise, just by faith. Now, if God asked me to do that 5 years earlier, I might not have been able to handle it. If he had asked me 5 years before that, listen, I'm just, you know, making a story out of it. Maybe I would have left him. Are you crazy? But you see, he built my faith to the point where moving to Charlotte with nothing by faith was something I had never done, but it wasn't much more than what I had just done and what I'd just seen. Here's my final statement. How can you build your faith if you never obey what God told you to do? Because if you don't obey, you'll never see the fulfillment of what he said. And if you don't obey and never see the fulfillment, you won't know he can do what he says he can do. The activation is not faith, it is obedience. Wait a minute. You see why the devil's after your obedience? Because obedience activates the move of God and builds your faith. See, faith is not a concept, faith is a muscle. And to get stronger in any area, you've got to exercise that muscle. When David was a little boy, God didn't say, hey, young man, go kill Goliath. What did David do first? He killed a
man.
And then he killed a
lion.
He killed those two first because God used that to build his faith. God is not going to ask you to do anything that you're not ready to do. But he is looking for someone who will do something and be willing. God, I can't do this thing, but I'm willing. God, this seems impossible. I'm willing. Why would he ask you to do that? Because he wants to expand your borders. He wants you to be greater, smarter, more powerful, more anointed, more gifted than any other believer or Christian you've ever seen. Why? Because it's the last days. Amen. And the Bible says the latter house must be greater than the former. And whether you're generation X, Y, Z, or just straight up nothing, God wants to use you. Amen. But the first thing is obedience. Amen. To his voice. Bow your heads, close your eyes. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this amazing service today. And I see clearly why the devil didn't want this to happen, why the devil was trying to stop it, but I also see why he's been defeated.
Yes.
Because God, you spoke to each one of our hearts, not just about your word, but about our walls. How can we see you move in our lives in a mighty way if we don't give you a mighty way to move? God, we're willing to push those walls forward. We're willing to make some space so you can bless us. With our heads bowed and eyes closed, if you're here today and you do not know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, or maybe you're just not sure. A lot of us have been going to church. Some of us have been water baptized. But we know in our hearts we've never made a clear-cut decision to give him our life, to give him our heart, and to let him be in control of our lives. And today we just want to say a simple prayer for you. I know some churches will shake your head, spit on you, baptize you immediately. We're not doing none of that. We just want to help you make a clear-cut decision in front of a few other believers that says, God, I need you. I believe Christ is the Son of God, and I want you to wash away my sins. I want you to come into my heart, and I want to be a new person. I want to be born again. That's all this is. Nothing crazy, nothing strange. And by saying this prayer, we're not going to trick you into joining our church. Some churches, you know, give your heart to Jesus, give your hand to the preacher. You can keep your hand in your pocket if you want to. The key is having a personal relationship with God. Not through grandma. Grandma's long skirts and no makeup was great for her. It might not work for you. I've learned that long skirts can go just as fast as the short ones. Mean for that to be my key point this morning. And I want y'all to tweet and text that. This is what the Lord said that they had to say.
That's going to be the folks later.
But on a serious note, God went out of his way to capture your heart this morning. Some of y'all went to that event yesterday, or the devil fought us to have that event yesterday. And look how he's fighting. Try to take my voice. Why? Because God is trying to speak a word, not to collect five offerings like where some of us came from, but to speak a word of life, speak a word of hope. But you've got to respond to out of obedience. If you're here today and you don't know him in the salvation and the saving of your sins, you don't know him, you're not born again, or you're not sure. There's nothing wrong with making sure today. Just quickly raise your hand where you are, and I'll pray with you. I see your hand. Anybody else? I see your hand. Anybody else? Put it up. Don't be scared, shy, embarrassed. Don't be slow. Come on now. We was giving away money. Hands will be up if you need him and you're not sure if he's in your heart right now. Just put your hand up. Anybody else? Don't miss this prayer today. Amen. Those who raise your hand and those of us who know him, let's say a prayer together. Say, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I thank you
for dying on the cross. For me.
Over 2,000 years ago. I need you in my life.
Wash away my sins.
Make me a new person. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.